I'm ready to start whenever. Okay.
Stop listening.
Later I will tell why. My music doesn't, it's not my music, and my music is not really related to this. I just want to. Yeah, it's much nicer than mine.
Thanks for coming, and it's our great pleasure to welcome here in the Academy of Music and Theatre and Music Innovation Center, Reso Madze, composer, improviser, and great guy.
It's a really great fun and honor and privilege to be here and to talk with a very diverse bunch of young people, young musicians here, who some of them just started composing, some of them is involved pretty long time in it. But independently how diverse the times are that they are occupied with creating music, they were all pretty interesting. And the questions were raising in this communication, sometimes which were very inspiring for me in the first place, because my way of seeing challenging music is very much connected to teaching, but this is not teaching like in Soviet times. I know something and telling others how to do or how it is, but actually we are both questioning the same problem, maybe from different aspects, and we're both trying how to learn and how to develop ourselves, how to come further and deeper into the matter. And actually I'm quite happy to say that my whole life is like that. I have been a student for a very long time, over 20 years, and I have been learning quite different stuff, and I was excited in quite different aspects of music and music making. And composition is just one of them. I don't regard myself as a saxophone player, but I play a lot of saxophone. I play a lot of jazz, but jazz is not the only thing I like playing my saxophone. I improvise a lot, freely, without any stylistic identity or self-identifying. My name is... Oh, let's... Yeah, there's one more topic. I come from Georgia, and maybe it's more or less known that Georgia has a very developed and very interesting traditional music. So I just want to steal at least 10 minutes of my time talking about my stuff and my person in music, and talk about Georgian traditional music. Although we don't have any connection, so my composition is not really related to Georgian music. I sometimes have some relationships in some later. So just a little geography before, because we all know each other. I mean, between Lithuania and Georgia, so between me and my Lithuanian friends, because I know that since my teenager times, and we're very close friends, it was always some airport we have to go. But sometimes it was just 3 hours flight, but mostly there was a Donetsk or some kind of, or something like that, some other airport. And between us was a huge monster connecting us in one country, in one state, in the Soviet times. We are happy, we both are happy that it's not any longer so. But just for a... I always love to see how small our countries are. This is Georgia. Let's make it bigger, because in this small country is quite huge the diversity of dialects, traditions, even cooking habits, and also musical approaches. Now this is this slide. This is how I am on Facebook. This is my private email. It's better because I don't know how long I will be rector, so rector's email not always relevant. And this is my Skype ID if somebody wants to contact me. But still, today I represent Tbilisi State Conservatoire, and it is the main musical educational institution in Georgia. Still, sometimes the old people working there regard themselves as the only music educating institution. It's no longer so, but it's one of the quite universal musical academies, because you can get your grade there on all three levels: bachelor, master, and doctor of music. This is what is written on its facade: Conservatoria, the Georgian alphabet, Georgian writing, by the way. This is how it was 100 years ago. We got this year, we were celebrating a centenary. And this is the first university in that region, in Caucasus. Even the Tbilisi State University is 1 year younger. They celebrate centenary next year. So, enough about Conservatoire, but is also Conservatoire that is hosting this website and this Center for Traditional, International Research Center for Traditional Polyphony. This is the main source also to get informed about Georgian traditional music. And one in two, every second year there's a huge symposium about traditional polyphony, where Georgia becomes a gravity center of traditional polyphony, and scholars from all over the world come to this place, to Conservatoire, and it's quite nice and quite interesting. I think Lithuanian scholars and ethnomusicologists have been also there and are regularly there. This website is also to, if you need just to have some examples or photos or videos of traditional music making, traditional Georgian music making. It's 10 more minutes left to have a look at the diversity of Georgian clothes, provinces, and now have just a listening sample, a short one. I will keep short. If somebody needs whole tracks of music, just contact me and I'll send. This music pretty often is doubted to regard this music as folk music. Singing is sometimes by some ethnomusicologists doubted as folk singing. It's too complex and too developed for a folk musician. But then we are asking ourselves what a folk musician is, or what a professional musician is. Okay, there is a farmer, he does his day job, he works in his field, he has his family, his animals, and making everything what a farmer does. But all the time he's thinking about how to melismate this or that syllable, or how to reharmonize something on his own way. So now call him what you want, but this guy is making this music. Okay, there's a collective music making. This is one more sign of folk music, but these are still these songs mostly regarded as music of some anonymous composers and traduced by orally, because most of them isn't written and wasn't written until the beginning of the 20th century. And that's why it's still being regarded as folk music sometimes, but it's better to call it Georgian traditional music with two really huge branches. This is secular singing and church music, church chant, Georgian chant. We'll talk maybe a very little bit about it. These are Georgian instruments. At least Georgians call it Georgian instruments, but these instruments are spread also all over the near Asia. Diplipito is quite unique for Georgia, but such instruments are all over the Asia in India and Pakistan and Afghanistan and maybe in China as well. So actually you could hardly say that some of these instruments is only Georgian or so, but they have a pretty developed practice in different regions of Georgia. And this salamuri, oh yeah, this doli is being regarded as very Georgian instrument, but it is plenty of in Turkey, in Armenia as well. And virtuoso playing of it is quite common. This instrument is called salamuri. This record is like. There are two types of it. It's with labium and without labium. And this thing made out of bone is being found, and it is dated with 12th century before Christ, so it's quite old thing. And some Georgian scholars, very ethnomistic scholars, working about Georgian tuning system, they say it's tuned in old Georgian way. But you know, if you ever play the recorder or some block flute, you know how light is to detune it with. So I don't think that this is something special. Anyway, this diversity of musical instruments is still nothing compared to the singing, because Georgian traditional music is merely a vocal tradition, and it's quite diverse as these instruments are. But we could divide them in Eastern and Western. Let's look the Eastern singing tradition. The very typical Bordun-like drone, the bass, and two upper voices are very melismated, and in an interval of third or fourth, they are and very seldom coming to unison. Oh, Is demonstrating. It's very seldom when you can listen to yodeling, Georgian yodeling as a solo. So let's listen to this short demonstration. Church, we will come to this choir once again, and a very interesting scholar. He's researching Georgian tuning system as well, and there are two very controversial theories. If we have time, I will tell about it later. Actually, the old recordings demonstrate us quite rough and very strong kind of singing, also in Eastern Georgia. The Bordon is good. This is Dedas Levana, Levana Savashvili. I'm just demonstrating it because the sound archive of British Library got 100 years old now, and they were, I was there in London recently, and I was listening to these things made by British sound recorders at that time, and it is quite emotional, actually. But even today you have a wonderful opportunity to listen still alive, to still alive singers like Mr. Benzenchvili here. He died a couple of years ago, but this video is quite new. And singing tradition is not something musical in Georgia. Everybody sings, actually. Maybe not everyone is such a master of singing like these families and dynasties. This is Anzor Erkumashvili, leader of ensemble, Rustavi ensemble. This ensemble from the earliest Soviet times was doing its best to preserve and carry the Georgian singing culture of every region. And this is his grandpa. Arthur Melkomashvili, who was the only living chanter in the 1960s, and they're singing a folk song now, not a chant. This music is being produced orally all the time. So at some point there was a very dangerous situation where old people were dying and this music was about to get lost, because the pneumatic notation of the 10th and 11th century, but for like this Iyadgari, like this hymn book by Mikhail Modrakili, these neumes are being studied, but they are not 100% clear what they and how to handle them, so it's in a research phase now. Neither these neumes, these are individual writings by Artem Melkomashvili, this old man we saw there, he was a very special kind of chanter who knew all three voices. So he was not only carrier of the cantus firmus, every chanter has to know it, but he also knew all the two other voices of his school, how it has to be harmonized, so that in the 20th century a great work has been done. Before, some priests in the beginning of the 20th century and end of the 19th century, this was terrible time because the Russification's politics, Georgian lost first time its independence 1801, and it became a governed colony of Russian Empire, and Georgian was kicked out from the church service as language and as music as well. So from that time on it started to get lost, and only these kinds in the Eastern Georgian schools, chanting schools, and Ektimekere Selidze and others, Filimon Koridze, in Western chanting schools, they started to try to record this singing in normal European notation, with a lot of mistakes, because the lower voice has to have one more flat or one less sharp to guarantee that at least the fifths are normal fifths and not get tritonus, not get diminished fifths. But what in the 60s was technology was that time not really developed like today, but this guy could sing all three voices. So one composer and one ethnomusicologist, this is Kahilo Sebashvili, very important composer in Georgia, and this is one of the most important ethnomusicologists of that time, Grigor Trikwadze. They both went to Guria and recorded. First they invited Artem Melkomashvili from Guria, from the Western Georgian province, and recorded him voice for voice with two tape recorders. Let's listen to this archive recording. This is only the first part. This is the first part, this is the canonic part by Cantus Firmus, not Cantus Firmus, but the main, which is in every school the same. This is the first and second part together.
I'm not a bee.
The quality is terrible. But today's technology allows guys, enthusiastic guys like Ilya Dzhakhava, young, not anymore, not student anymore, but very young music ethnomusicologist and very enthusiastic guy, a friend of mine. He is also technically very, very enthusiastic, and remastered this recording and put out wonderful 14 or over 10, 14 to or 12 or 14 wonderful chants sung by Artem Yakomashvili. It sounds like that. Could have get lost, or even do other pearls of Georgian music, if not ensembles like that. They were sometimes too big, they were sometimes singing more tempered than in this kind of special Georgian tuning system, but still they preserved a lot of thousands of songs, like also these editions. And in my second student time in the 80s, I was the member of this choir. And this choir was quite funny because nobody was a real singer there. I was composer, three others also composers. These two were ethnomusicologists. One was a piano player, played like the Chopin, but he has one of the most interesting yodeling voices actually. And the other guy, this was mathematician and informatic guy. He's now searching about Georgian Nooms, also very important member of the Antishati choir. This was the leader, the second from the right, but he has another choir now, and now is the leader, Datush Uliashvili, also a composer, also an ethnomusicologist, one of the important ones. I would just, I would like to play for you the recording. Our voices are still still weak and trembling. We cannot really hold it on, but it was the first recording of ours in a very, very reverberated monastery not far from Tunis. Now in researching Georgian tuning system, but here we are singing kind of tempered. And we were not only getting out of the archives and manuscript institutes these preserved notation examples of it, but we were also going around Georgia and going to such old singers and learning from them how to handle it, how to handle our voices. Meanwhile, this choir is quite famous, and these two leaders, so this is the former leader, this is the actual leader, they are doing a lot research. Actually, in the 80s already, these were two diploma works which were like palms in the ethnomusicology, because Malchaz made his first research results of Georgian tuning system, and Dato made for the first time, because it was spoken about chanting and singing dialects in Georgia, and he was the first who demonstrated that there's no dialects but different, maybe three or four diverse schools of harmonizing, and the Georgian chant is totally unified, always been totally unified, and its main voice was always the same with a little variance. And this is what is what it has also common with the rest of the Orthodox Christian music, liturgical music, etc. This guy is researching, as I said, about Georgian gnomes. They both are quite controversial researchers of Georgian tuning system. The most complicated approach to Georgian tuning system is by Malfa Serponidze and by Levon Meshapidze. This theory is so simple that it's also kind of problematic, but very plausible. This is more plausible. I mean, maybe the truth is something somewhere in between, but this is talking about equally tempered system of 10 steps in an octave, where there are no major and minor threats, just third, and no major and minor seconds, just seconds. So neither there are sixths and sevenths, major and minor, just sixths. In this sense, everything recorded and adjusted in computer exact tuning system manually, it sounds so plausible and so similar to the old recordings of thinking that this is very, very, very attractive, this theory. But Malchaz is very angry about it because he's how can the whole Georgian music have only one mood and one scale? So he's against it. But the guys think together sometimes. And this is kind of, I don't know what it's here. Oh yeah, yeah, for example, if we have time, let's listen to this. Computer adjusted and edited. Practicing actually to sing so that you are not tended to sing smaller, minor or major, second and third, but it's, I think the guys try, give their best. Yeah, meanwhile, the situation of Georgian traditional music is really a dream situation because there's a lot of founding resources to preserve and to study all this material, like Georgian Chant Foundation is one of these. They also did their best, and there's a University of Georgian Chant or Georgian Traditional Music where you can study a lot. So there's really time to expect that this preserving time is at last finally over, and now it can develop further or something. There's a lot of theories how to develop this music, how to not only make covers of already existing approaches and variants, but also try to melismate on their own, because this research is already gone that far. So this was my try to make a 15-minute introduction of Georgian traditional music. I needed the whole half an hour. Now I don't know how many time we have, but maybe I will talk. I promised also the students I was meeting these 2 days. it was very interesting. It were very interesting musical experiences for me as well, because on one side I know the situation in Tbilisi State Conservatoire and the couple of composers there. They're also different, but there are certain tendencies which are not got rid of. And here I observe very successful and a very attractive way of dealing with a total diversity of different musicalities, different aesthetical approaches and interests, and this is wonderful. I think we have to learn it, to approach to young people wanting to make music with its own diversity. Because the word academic, meanwhile, is one of the most hated words by me, because behind this academic, or in this in the coat of academic, sometimes hides a very big deal of retrograde and conservative mindset, and this is quite tragic for young musicians in general. But Georgian Conservatoire has done some pretty good progress in terms of jazz department. For example, we have it on bachelor level now, already 4 years, and we have a very interesting and very active young community, which is very attractive. It's really fun to be around, among them, and to play, make music with them, and they develop so fast that they get best places also abroad as students, etc., in Berkeley or Siena Jazz, etc. And some of them still being in Georgia make a very good and attractive jazz scene worth to listen. Gittis knows, has already seen a couple of them. This is a title of my doctorate work, which is still in progress, and I don't know when I'm finished with my doctor work, but maybe someday it will come out with this title, I don't know. This is the main thing, and so we can move to my music. Actually, questions in my music. If you're tired, I can make it shorter, but just a few things I would like to say. How many time shall we decide? One more hour or half an hour? Well, what is better for
you? One more hour.
One more hour? Would it be okay? So, you can stop me anytime. My musicianship started quite late. Okay, as a child I was I was learning several languages and music at the same time. My parents were told that one helps another. It looks like it's quite useful to learn music and languages together, because both seem to help each other a lot. This is so would my business card look, and mostly why it is here, I don't know. No matter. This is one of the sentences I like very much, because very often I'm talking about music, and this music where I'm talking about is perceived by most of the others as not music. You're talking about something else. And then I have to cite one of the most beloved and respected composers, where he just said, you don't have to call it music if it hurts, but still there is some very focused and very narrow approach to music where I feel always to have to propagate and to have to win and argue for expanding the limits of the term music itself. And if we regard music as a sounding reality, and I'm quite happy with it today, and just add to these three components. Okay, this is one, the conventional musical categories that you have been always transformed, and so the normal and well-known development of music, for example, European classical music, is there. From the 20th century on, there was a quite nice achievement of technology to get its foot into music, and musicians or technicians started to expand the limits of music with, for example, music concrete. This is music which is not born in our heads or hearts as an abstract musical idea, but it is based on material or sounding world of our everyday life, and by recording except of them, regarding them as objets sonore, sounding objects, and transforming them and distributing them in time, getting the final result of a music concrete piece. On a fixed media, it was a shellac disc or tape later, and so on. The other movement, also thanks to the technology, revolutionary movement, was known today as sound synthesis, not music, sound synthesis. And this is suddenly getting an opportunity to get on the lowest level of sounding wave, which can be between 20 and 20,000 hertz and be audible and don't have any overtones. It was for the first time thanks to electronic technology, because in our physical reality every object, most deaf ones, vibrate in as a whole, as a half, as a third, etc. So it's our multiple factors of it, and so we have an overtone row which is a cage we cannot escape in our physical reality, unless we start make these overtone rows not according to these physical proportions, half and third and fourth, etc., or 2 times, 3 times, and 4 times, etc. But we can add these differently pitched or different frequency sound tones of different frequency together, and so get to the timbres which in normal physical world wouldn't exist. We can compose them electronically. But what we are doing now is quite revolutionary, because a composer was never able to compose a timbre. He was mixing up several existing physical realities as timbres. For example, a trumpet timbre with cello. So electronic technology made for the first time a composer also capable to compose a sound. He's not composing with different sounds, a music piece, but he's composing the sound itself. This is quite dramatic, I think. This has to be translated, actually. this is the same thing, but I would add this also, because computer music, so computer developed and are now capable to handle audio as well as video material in a way that these data streams are already able to, in a quite fluent way, describe any audio or video processes going. If we take the term physical modeling, this is a description like a data package or data flow of, for example, a cello played by a bow. And it can be described with a huge data package, so that we can even then manipulate it and say more or less colophonium on the hair of the bow, thicker or thinner string, etc. And we can actually simulate and manipulate this package. Now let's take another package of a trumpet and our lips vibrating and lip tension, etc. We can have also a huge duct package. But now imagine we can we are already in a virtual world, so we can manipulate or converge these data packages together, so that what in real world would be a nonsense, for example playing cello string with a trumpet mouthpiece, it wouldn't be that interesting. It's quite interesting results when I play in this physical modeling world a cello string with my trumpet mouthpiece. And so I don't think that many of the musicians are very excited about this idea, but actually composer is doing something, as we know from the music history, what is not, part of the composers. If we compare Johann Sebastian Bach and Richard Wagner, these two differ from each other because one was making the existing musical reality, actually without anything inventing new, he was leading to every existing music category to its top. The other guy, Mr. Wagner, he was trying to change something, just sometimes just for the sake of change. For example, his intention was to invent a hybrid between French horn and trombone. And we got Wagner tuba, arranging sound in space so that we got this pirate theater with its all very strange sound leading architecture. So actually the nature of composers sometimes is demanding to manipulate everything, every other, any reality around you, so that let's skip Pythagoras, but it's quite nice idea that the world of numbers is the key to everything in our world, in our seen and imagined world. Or Gottfried Wilhelm von Leibniz's sentence that music is a hidden arithmetic exercise of the soul, which does not even realize that it is counting. Or the algorithmic compositional concepts of 18th century by Athanasius Kircher. Or this completely crazy passage in this utopic novel of Francis Bacon, The New Atlantis. It's quite known site about king of an island who is telling the travelers, we have sound houses where we practice and demonstrate all sounds and their generation. And there is a quite a long text with a lot of techniques mentioned which are completely impossible in the 17th century. This is nonsense to say of amplifying or pitch shifting or resampling and sending over network. And these things are mentioned 300 years before their reality, because in 20th century we are gone. So I think one of the great impulses and forces advancing forces for arts and for human being actually, is vision of something which is not possible in actual technological situation, but which is always being aimed as something which that is worth to be reached. And the other possible, the other situation is to look around and in every detail of your reality, looking for a musical potential. For example, what I would do with this phone, or what I would do with this wire, etc. These two forces could be enough to come to a music which is far beyond the notion of the most of the humans, what music is. If you ask some people where music ends for them, they would name you a pretty limited area of real music. The rest is for them either noises or something. And you can argue with them that everything what sounds can be regarded as music. My perception or my vision of music was quite limited as well, but somehow it happened that I got to Germany, I met the right people, or I got the right difficulties in thinking about music, or I got the right adventures which I experienced, and now I'm really working in different fields of music with fun. Sometimes I don't even want to mix them up, because I love to have been a choir member where we sang Georgian traditional music, but Georgian traditional music is almost never reflected in my compositions. Composition is something completely special, so I don't like to mix it up with jazz or jazz-like music, which I enjoy in original as well. So when so my business card would look like that: composition, saxophone, electronics. I don't regard myself for a very versatile electronic musician, neither for a saxophonist at all. And my composition is also sometimes just a way to get away from everything and try to do something. But I improvise a lot in this situation, and it's quite. This is quite typical for me, because here all three aspects of my music making there. I play saxophone. My computer has a patch open, which I regard as my composition, because this is an environment with a lot of rules of a game I'm playing with. I'm acting and interacting with my computer, and I'm improvising. It's not composed what I'm playing now. We can skip until this guy starts to protest. But students are listening quite carefully. It's the Academy of Arts, by the way, it's not conservatoire. But somebody is making, he's about to throw a couple of bottles, but he did not, so I could finish this improvisation. I play also jazz, as I said. This is, and I love playing with young people. They play all better than I ever, but it's pretty much fun. What I'm really proud of, it's an improvisation ensemble I founded many years ago. First it was ensemble where non-musicians, students of a university, I was teaching electroacoustic music, they just picked up different instruments, and our improvisation started with exploring these instruments. So music making was exploration of a unknown field or something like that. And it was quite interesting. Then I had an improvisation ensemble, or some students subscribed to a course of improvisation in the conservatoire, and suddenly Swiss accordionist and composer Jonas Kocher came to Georgia, and we made a concert together, and then he gave a workshop to conservatoire students, where my Ilya University students also came. And my Ilya students were already pretty good improvisers with anything you gave him then. But these instrumentalists, these virtuosos, could not do anything. Were so irritated, they suddenly had to improvise. On the next day, they knew what to do, and they were the best improvisers, of course. But the first annoyance made me to think that something is wrong in classical musical education, because the European music history has profited with improvisation with like nothing else. Yeah, imagine Baroque or the Renaissance music and so on, or music of the 20th century. And suddenly we were stuck in the very narrow approach to European music of classical romanticism. And even there, I guess there were a lot of improvisational moments. Schumann is writing about improvising, preferring the composition to it, but still mentioning it. And this quadlibet and house music making of Bach's family, etc. Anyway, I founded this ensemble at the time, but now it's a couple of years later, it's over 2015, and they play quite interesting. And I have fun playing them. This guy is an Australian and one of the most interesting. It can get quite intensive, but sometimes we are very transparent. And if we talk about, I forgot to translate some of the slides, but it's okay. You will just have a look how Georgian writing. I will tell what it is. So it's the most comfortable way to regard myself, so from my point of view as a composer. But I'm really, really lost between composition and improvisation. And I even made a lecture about composition and improvisation to try to hold them apart and then come to a conclusion very dramatically, to conclusion that this is all the same. Of course it is the same. In between is an interpretation, also some questionable circumstance. There was a very stupid word invented by a professor in the Musikhochschule Lübeck where I was studying. I don't like this word. This word doesn't mean anything, but sometimes it helps. But composition, what is it and how it differs from the improvisation? I was trying to figure out. This is something conceived, organized, and arranged, etc., etc. And on the other side, improvisation is spontaneous, not planned, interactive, etc. So we could say that composition is somehow opposite of improvisation and vice versa. But then I was starting to questioning this versus, and tried to sort out this history of tradition or categories of music making. And historically we have oral tradition, then notation, so the interpretation got important, then the second revolution by recording, and then I'm coming to a conclusion that composition is quite a deal of composition in improvisation, and improvisation is itself also there while composing. So I was questioning this versus, and then I started to make some stupid conceptions about interacting between composition and this is it. This was wrong. So I tried to make different pictures of improvisation and how much composition is in jazz improvisation. Let's leave swing alone. But the bebop era, I was demonstrating on this blues recorded twice by Charlie Parker Quintet, one of the most interesting and most valuable bands of that time. It's 1947. The theme is quite simple. It's a blues theme, and it's repeated. The blues chorus of 12 bars is repeated octave lower then. The recording technique, so thank to great Thomas Edison and Emil Berliner afterwards, because Sherlock Records won then, because it was the Edison technology of wax cylinders was too expensive. We would have no idea how really Charlie Parker sounded. The thing comes after this song, right? Charlie Parker is much more free and much more spontaneous in his improvisations, and young Miles Davis is much more compositionally oriented. And composition in jazz musician's life is quite a deal, because he is practicing and paying his dues, as it is called, by inventing patterns and combinations of patterns which he is using while improvising on any tune that later. Depends on harmonic sequence. And this is only partly improvisation. It's quite a deal of compositional work done before. And afterwards, I will mention you some compositions which are exactly the same. Actually, they're given compositional entities, and you're mixing up it with different means, computer or variable techniques in Klavierstück. Anyway, let's listen to it. Okay, I don't pretend that you remember the whole solo of Parker and Miles Davis, but you will see. You will notice that Parker's solo dealing with other things, and Miles Davis' motifs you will recognize again. That's one repetition. jazz improvisation develops in 20 years, they approach this improvisation. Okay, there's a big mainstream which do it the same way as in bebop times and hard bop times, but this guy, his best band again, his second quintet, plays, there are changes, there's form, but sometimes they completely ignore it. And how this band grooves and how they are still together harmonically and in time, it's amazing. That's just a short excerpt. Davis, Wayne Shorter, Ron Carter, in the middle of Herbie Hancock's very intensive playing, Miles comes and starts the hand again, so there's no respect of form or something, he just, it's kind of a free jazz, which came actually already a couple of years earlier in this wonderful record of Ornette Coleman. There's a double quartet, two drummers, two bass players, and two and two wind players. Here, the harmony and form doesn't even exist. They're just cueing each other, maybe Ornette with his alto, to set some clock. But still, this is a composition. Maybe you can help me to tell why. But I believe this is composed. And even this is composed. Interstellar Pace, this is the last studio recording of Joe Coltrane. He died in several months. He just called a drummer, not even a drummer. Rashid Ali was not a professional drummer, but he was playing in his band. He just called him. They went to studio and recorded Interstellar Space. Look how it sounds. No head, no form, nothing. It's just a... But the composition in terms of Coltrane is choosing an actor. So it's a sound for him. Rashid Ali is a sound. The texture, sound, and form. Okay, form is not spoken, not agreed about, but they play. This is a decision which can be enough for the composition, as we will see later. Years when I'm not rector anymore, I will transcribe this, although I have to learn this. Transcribing, it's actually, jazz is an art, is a musical art of where the imitation is a very big deal. We can call even it art of imitation, because the whole jazz life of a musician, developing musician, is first having a hero or several heroes today, and transcribing and copying their solos. Even a saxophonist may be fond of Bud Powell's lines, for example, he's transcribing pianists about Paul's lines and learning them. Or vice versa, pianists and guitarists are influenced by Charlie Parker's music, as everyone, and so on. And then some of them have luck to find their own individualities, then they become guys like Coltrane and Sonny Rollins, or Chris Potter. And some of them just stay good musicians and act in different big bands or their own bands, but not. Let's move to the composition. It was a very brief and schematic description of improvisation in just one case in jazz, but with whole concepts, because I touched different stages of jazz improvisation. In composition, okay, this is completely opposite. It's a concept, a form, and organized material, and you can stop and go back and change something and so on. So it's something conceived, organized, determined is very good. Let's have a look at this wonderful piece from the Art of Fugue. This canon is two-part, but the idea of canon is what is there has to be in the second part there, and also augmented and inverted. So what I'm composing here, I have to follow it there. I can be spontaneous even in this composing, but then I'm obliged to do it. But what is the counter subject of this is, again, test is obligatory for the following bars. It's restricting oneself in a method and finding some freedom in this restriction. You are reacting, actually, what you have composed there, you're reacting in the counter subject on this, because otherwise it wouldn't fit in the language of the counterpoint, and so on. Then it's after the second half, it's turning and the opposite starts. Okay, well, there were A's are here, both are here, and so on. Yeah, composition is determined by musical material a couple of bars before. What is the determination of composition here? These letters, Lettres dansantes from the Carnival, Schumann's Carnival. And acoustically, we're about to listen to a very romantic, nice piece, but it's determined by a medieval technique of deriving notes from letters. These are these four notes: La, Mi bemol, Do, Si, etc. Okay, if we compare Bach's determination of other aspects of this composition, neither tempo nor dynamics, nothing is there. Here's tempo, here's tempo, and dynamics, quite a few. And this is going farther. In the 19th century, later, so many determination by a composer what an performer has to do and follow, like tempo, dynamics, even voice leading, and sorting out more important and less important voices. Sorry for that sound. Skip. This is maybe the climax of determining everything. Not only the tone row, like in dodecaphony, but this is a completely fascistic, serialistic work of determining everything and underlying everything to a row. No, I'm just kidding, because this is one of the most interesting musical approaches to pitches and to all parameters of music. Really, it's so, it can get so pedantic. If not messianic, wouldn't be a good piece, I guess. This is an electronic version, because you cannot differ between so many different stages, different levels of dynamics. This, what's going on here? Here is something determined which is actually not really important, whether it will be 142 times or 141 or 138 times. Nobody's counting this. There's a little stop in pianissimo, but the same thing happens 87 times. Let's listen to it. Because we're laughing, but it has some kind of very, very important and mesmerizing effect. And this is one of the greatest piano pieces at all, we know it. And the penibility or penible, the X. Wonderful. Single voice melody. And what a contrast, actually, to this. And so on. This electronic piece is so determined and so exactly described that it can be re-realized by Georg Haidu, wonderful Hamburg composer. German composer teaching in Hamburg. He made a digital Max Mesmer realization of this wonderful piece, because everything is totally exactly described, and there was no need in it, because the piece is as a tape piece, so you could switch on tape and listen to it. But this thing was almost a must-be written description of this piece, like a graphical score, and this is a compositional statement, I would say. So this is something which you would seek for improvisational moments with the least success. Actually, almost nothing can be regarded here as spontaneous. But the same composer, oh yeah, shall we listen to it? No. You know it. Elektronische Studie Nummer 2. This is, okay, well, let's listen to the beginning. These are the frequency mixtures, and these are the dynamics of the every mixture here. We are fine. there was a page missing. This is also a masterpiece of early electronic music, 1954, it is composed. Now let's move to the same composer's another, they say, masterpiece, Austin Siebenthaler. This is a textbook, actually. Not a single note is written there. The first piece, I translated it in English. The first piece looks like that. Richtige Dauern in German, right durations. Look, play a sound. Play it for so long until you feel that you should stop. Again, play a sound, play it for so long, and so on. Stop when you feel you should stop. But whether you play or stop, keep listening to the others. At best, play when people are listening. And then comes the shock. Do not rehearse. Probe nicht auf Deutsch. This is... This is something which... this is really exciting, because this guy can determine everything, like in Studie Nummer 2, this electronic study, number 2, and suddenly get excited of situation where nothing is determined before, almost nothing. Nothing is determined, we will get to this guy again. The only thing is, play when you think you should play, and stop when you think you should stop. It's crazy. So, and I'm a young composer who is thinking, what is composition, what is improvisation? I mean, why I'm telling you all these things? Because it's really not annoying, but at last it's somehow annoying, but at the end of in end effect, you are just excited about ambivalency of this whole music making. Okay, we all know this guy and this wonderful piece, which is known as most significant piano piece in the world. So I won't talk long about it, but the only determination, compositional intention, is here that there is no intention and no determination. Even the time, 4:33, it was a formal, for the first performance, formal circumstance, they say maybe to give a tribute to Robert Rauschenberg, American painter, who was painting this differently formatted white paintings, for example. Because his words about it, sort of the later times, he say, there is no day passes without thinking about this piece, and sometimes I don't even need to sit down and think of it. And actually we can just open a window or close a window or sit and listen to it. As soon as we determine this is the piece, we are listening to it. And everything is a point of view, actually. And Schoenberg's paraphrase, I think two or three students heard it today or yesterday from me. Schoenberg's kind of a sentence, I'm paraphrasing because I don't know, have the exact words. That the art starts when you start regarding something very usual as something very special. And this is the first stage of making art. The other, how able you are to develop it so that others see the same vision as you see, it's second step already. But the first moment of art happens when you're in viewing things, in vision, in regarding things otherwise. And this is kind of, I don't know. Yeah, so my musical development was quite controversial. And I was composing with certain excitement and inspiration, but with heavy difficulties sometimes also. And improvisation always was my kind of helping. up to this, including this one, this is Maximilian Marco on laptop and me on saxophone. We are not connected or interacting between each other. We are both improvising simultaneously. Actually kind of later stage of my improvisational interests. This is one of the most interesting, for me, most interesting musical experiences with John Eckert and Lukas Nikli in Kubus, Switzerland. These improvisations are really composed only by bringing people together. But they have this compositional intention that we have to play three numbers and we have that and that time. Okay, just the beginning. Involved in this contemporary music scene of Germany and Switzerland. Now let's look at a fact which is pretty much known. Alan Parker and his electroacoustic ensemble records its improvisational performances with as many tracks as possible, sometimes 12 and sometimes 24, and then they have a phase of very, very subtle and thorough cutting and mixing it up until bringing out the CD. It is improvisation, but they compose out of this improvisation a fixed media piece. And this is also kind of reason to think that there must be not that much difference between improvisation and composition. I forgot the name of the This is Ewan Parker, great guru of improvising music. And this is John Russell. Yeah, this last 20 minutes we don't have that much time. Georg Haydn's conception of real-time composition itself is something like very good support for me to bring these two notions, these two terms together, improvisation, composition, because here, compositionally is every circumstance made for your for improvising in a certain pre-composed game rules. And this is a wonderful thing. You can get familiar to it on Georg Haydn's page or on the page of Hamburger Hochschule for music and theater. So why I'm talking so much and making you tired, I just want to prove for me in the first time that there is no difference between composition and improvisation, and that my music making could be regarded something like a mix of it, or composition in improvisation in composition. If you are still not tired and give me 20 minutes, I can go through a couple of pieces of mine, because only talking could be less plausible than just to show how my compositional difficulties came and how I try, I'm still trying to solve them, because I'm not a very fluent composer. I'm mostly spend a lot of energy and time on conciping and asking me why, and not being able to answer why. But I was lucky enough to study by Micho Shugliashvili, who was kind of a very interesting mix of intuition, where your wish and emotion and intention starts to come up, and ability, where you are technically equipped and your knowledge and ratio and technique serve and this the fulfillment, the realization of your intuitional first stage of making art. This is Micho Shugliashvili, Georgian composer, the most neglected and less underestimated composers until recently. Now a Swiss musical circle started to bring up his heritage, his works, and performing them one after another last years, and is one of the most interesting composers of Georgian musical life. He's been regarded as Xenakis of Georgian music, actually. He's very constructively oriented, and he wants always a process to be structurized and constructed after a progression or some kind of textural or pitch-based or any rule. He died in 1996, in age of 55 years, on the top of his happiness, because the Soros Foundation, Open Foundation Georgia, I don't remember the exact name, got some funding to make him possible studio, computer-equipped studio, the nicest and most up-to-date studio of that time. And the studio started to build. He had his pupils of every generation. Actually, he was working with kids like that, and grown up young composers like us that time. And every more or less significant composer of today has been in his class up to today. It's a very funny thing. And he was just sharing his thoughts about structure and time with his students, and proportion. The next triad could be the number and distribution and density, very important thing. And one more triad, maybe progression and polychrony and texture. And actually I started to learn by at his place or in his lessons to these two aspects of music, of course, time as written structure and space, pitch and harmony. And later on in Germany, I was happy to get to meet this wonderful text of Karlheinz Stockhausen, Wie die Zeit vergeht, How Time Passes, where he is talking and also complaining actually about the lack of coherency between logarithmic scale of pitches and linear scale of durations. And he is inventing different tempo manipulation methods to get his Gruppen für drei Orchester, this wonderful orchestra piece, maybe most wonderful orchestra piece of 20th century, to get it to work. It's a dodecaphonic piece, but with a lot of different, very thorough ideas. This text is being criticized by Adrian Fokker, a Dutch physicist. Not ni chirurg, a physic. But very, very thoroughly defended by a wonderful, another great composer, Gottfried Michael Koenig. These three texts should have been translated and published together, because it's a very interesting discussion or polemics of the 60s. Wonderful. So my main thank to Michal Shugliashvili was to learning how to sort out music as a bunch of parameters, and how to think of music and sound as having different parameters which can not only interact or be simultaneously there, but also interchange. And this is not Micho's invention or invention of the music of the 20th century. This 17th century technique of soggetto calato, Josquin des Prez, etc., of mapping letters on notes, etc., was actually well known. Robert Schumann will be head, it's not necessary. And still, my first orchestra piece. Okay, just before, there were some pieces where I was quite traditional and conventional in my composing. No, the texture was not really conventional, it was like this kind of a half cluster or what, and with a singing voice. I was actually, this texture with such kind of bass and a singing voice, it was quite seldom in my musical life that I was dreaming of a music several days. Okay, one day and one day then, or not a week and then again, until I found the text, and this text fitted very much to this singing voice and this piano texture. So I made a nice song on Christian Morgenstern. I don't have the recording of it, unfortunately. So my first more or less earnest piece was this, Melismata, actually. It's a tonal piece based on basso continuo of Bach's Saraband from his English suite, the sixth one, D minor. And it's a tonal piece, but the liner polyphony, could be called the technique. I really use the technique. It's not really seriously technique. It's just I'm letting every instrument of this band, of this big orchestra, playing its own melody on the basso continuo harmonic situation, on this general bass. In the beginning, I'm sorting out and making, just taking care of nice sounding contrapunt, but later and later, we don't have to, it messes up. It's in tonal thing, but this sounding masses are very cluster-like and bringing quite interesting, very peculiar sensation of tonality. And this was when I was composing traditionally, but very soon after that, it was 1991, I went to Germany, and all was already really heavily irritated because of timing problems in the composition. I was writing something happening now, And on the next day I was rewriting it, happening a bit later, maybe an eighth later, or a quarter earlier, or something like that. So I was then really in conflict with music written in bars and in measures. And I had quite a difficulty to determine, to get rid of timing in music. And in Lübeck, I was still, I did not still have a flat where I would live. So I lived sometimes by a student, sometimes by a nice older lady who just took up students that had nothing to leave, and so my stipend wasn't there yet, and I was just listening to Cage and Lutoslawski and reading Christian Morgenstern poems, and I suddenly encountered the correspondence of Witold Lutoslawski with Walter Levin, the first violinist of some students have heard about it already, and how he was defending and arguing for this kind of notation. Look, these are four frames for each instrument, and each one is playing its passage to the end, and then when everybody is finished, moving to the next page of the quartet. And if I do that, it goes. And only some vertical synchronizations are there. The rest is to be played everyone by himself. And this kind of encounter was like rescuing. It saved, actually. I was already thinking not to compose anymore and just to improvise. This cycle of six songs, Notturni, is built on a kind of such notation. Let's listen to it just a short minute. I have ten more minutes, right? Is it okay? I'm sorry, I'm always... Oh, sorry, it's... This is only the second page, sorry. This is the first page. Yeah. Actually, the same thing happens here. This texture, it doesn't really matter when, in what relationship is one note to another. Everybody has guaranteed part of a 12-stone row, and it sounds every time like this. Okay, the second take would sound a slightly different way, but imagine how much energy and time I would waste to write out the order of it. And this order is not needed, really. I'm really happy when I listen to a slightly other constellation of the same notes. Q is echtste, this text, and gleich als auch. And here, they know that they have to be synchronous to a pulse, because everybody is playing from the score. Passage of it is just like beginning. Yeah, after that I was not really happy for a long time, because this can get also quite boring. This is the fourth song of it. I cannot say that this was this was just one thing, and then I was a composer and I was very comfortable with my composing. Very often I still needed some non-musical, or today I call it extra-musical, situation to derive my material from. Like on in this piece, this is an antiphonie for 20 strings. And these are proportions derived from so-called musical and non-musical letters of two names, Mikhail Shugliashvili, my first teacher, and my professor of that time, Friton Dürr, in the Musikoper in Lübeck. And, okay, non-musicals would be M and I would be non-musical, C and H and A and E are musical letters, etc. So there are four phrases, but these musical and non-musical order determines also the durations of the phrases, but also the structures. This is the disposition of musicians. Violino, there are 12 violins in front, and violoncello, 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 violocontrabass. And the groups occur like solo or two against three, three against four, and then one. And the culmination is half against half. Let's listen to this short piece. Oh, wait, sorry. Yeah, this is the, we must not listen to it, but. Yeah, but this rules of this game suddenly are getting boring, and I have only one night to finish the piece, and I'm getting very nervous and stressed out, because it's no chance to keep composing like this and getting it finished for the next morning's 10 o'clock, where the rehearsal is already. So I'm about to call Gia Vancelli, who engaged me for this commission, and with apologies tell him I'm not managing to do it. And suddenly came this. This is the frame, this is one note. This is the last chord where all the notes of these structures are present. We have to listen to it, I think, because the last piece, it lasts only 6 minutes. Yeah, and the musicians get the prescription on the sign of the conductor. He's playing what he wants from this former part, what he already played. And it's quite a nice piece. I would the premiere was in a Berlin church in Kreuzberg. Arvopiat was attending it and said a couple of nice words to it. But said, yeah, very nice. But you can get even slower, even softer. Second constellation. Yeah, and the timings are most quite like in Gruppen orchestra. The tempo is determined by the real timing. The music, they had all monograms. Collage of Johannes Brahms' Vier Ernste Gesänge, and this is called Vier Ernste Bagatellen. This electric piece you will listen to tomorrow. In orchestra piece, it worked quite well. Just the orchestra musicians are less motivated than young musicians of Tbilisi Chamber Orchestra. But the sound they're getting out from this is quite nice, actually. Because many things happen randomly together. And I have quite bad experience with pieces. No, this is okay. With pieces like when I write everything exactly, and they are messed up by the humans. So sometimes I decide to divide exact music for computers and improvised music for humans. Nevertheless, there's one more thing which is very important for me. Since already 10 years actually, I'm deriving my pitches, tonal material, as well as timing, from different sound files. Sound file can be that short, couple of seconds, and just stretched. Because while stretching, you are getting a lot of artificial interpolations into this. Or when the sound file is long enough, I'm making a spectral analysis of it. Sometimes I even make it real time. It's kind of ritual. I run the sound file and my max patch analyzes it with either a fiddle object or pitch object or analyzer. This is a newer one, I think. And writes in real time a MIDI file, which I just import into a notation software, and then I'm starting to interpreting these derived pitches into my music. This is this technique has been my main composing motivation for 10 years, I think. Last piece I composed, it was an orchestra commission from Lublin Orchestra, and I composed 2015 a piece dedicated to a Georgian priest which has been killed in Warsaw ghetto. Anyway, this kind of dependence on a sound file is for me of a crucial importance, because the sound file is not just a sound file, it is always connected with the situation I want to be inspired from while composing. And that's why I can suddenly take three sound files when I'm writing for a trio traffic. Just a very short excerpt of my piece, how it sounds, where it is. Oh, sometimes such pieces have also been, because there were good musicians. And in case of good musicians, you can give them this, and then let them play this using what they have given, what they have been given. These five pages for interpretation were one of my most successful experiences in my composition. Unfortunately, there's no recording of it. But I'm still making soggetto cavato technique with this Goethe lead, etc. It's quite nice. This you will hear next. L'Audiomast. Tomorrow in concert there will be electronic pieces, so I don't want to talk about them now. This is this three sound files transcribed. Notation is quite nice. The question whether I'm not too dependent on something which is random and doesn't have to do with my spiritual or aesthetical or artistic intention is wrong, because I have experienced that such kind of composing, or any kind of composing, is very close related to my spiritual and aesthetical and so on situation of that time while composing. Actually, I believe very much that it doesn't matter with which technique and what note material and for what instrument you compose. Actually, what you do, it corresponds to your state of being very much. So I can say that my questions and research through parameters of music continue. I don't know when I get bored by this. Now I'm quite enthusiastic about composing. I just have not very much time, but I still hope to finish my rector cadence and be composer again, composer and musicians. Anyway, I apologize that I took so much time of yours, and thank you very much. My compositions won't be that long, it's only 40 minutes in total, and I don't even know whether all my pieces will come tomorrow or not. Maybe we'll cancel one of them, but it will be about 1 hour of talk and my pieces. Thanks again. Thank you. Sorry, it was quite long. Thank you very much.
I would love to, yes. If it is in the morning, right?
Yes.
Because Mantaldas said that
if you have a special,
we will do sound check here later in the afternoon. So it is quite possible for me, if it's okay for your time.
To
it's the improvised music students.
Wonderful.
Yeah, it's like 10 minutes walk from here.
Ah, 10 minutes walk from here. Wonderful. Is it not...